All gather here in your house this morning to worship and adore you. Thank you, Father, for keeping us safe under your wings throughout the past week and all the experiences of our life. We come with all the experiences. We come with everything that we go through. We bring it all at your feet and we submit ourselves. We pray that we may leave behind all thoughts of the world and that we may gather ourselves so that we may focus on you, on Jesus alone. Help that in this worship and our participation in the Holy Communion and our listening to the Word of God. We will have a transformative spiritual experience. We pray for our Achan who is leading us in the service. We pray for all your children who are helping in the conduct of this service in various ways. We pray for your children who are still on the way. Keep us all safe. Bless us. Help that we may experience your living presence. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Let us continue our worship by singing together hymn number 8 from the order of worship. Please be seated. Now the lessons shall be read.
The first lesson for the morning is taken from 2 Kings chapter 2, 1 to 15. 2 Kings chapter 2, verse 1 to 15. Now when the Lord was about to take Elijah up to heaven by a whirlwind, Elijah and Elisha were on their way from Gilgal. And Elijah said to Elisha, "Please stay here, for the Lord has sent me as far as Bethel." But Elisha said, "As the Lord lives and as you all yourself live, I will not leave you." So they went down to Bethel, and the sons of the prophets who were in Bethel came out to Elisha and said to him, "Do you know that today the Lord will take away your master from over you?" And he said, "Yes, I know. I keep quiet." Elijah said to him, "Elisha, please stay here, for the Lord has sent me to Jericho." But he said, "As the Lord lives, and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So they came to Jericho. The sons of the prophets who were at Jericho drew near to Elisha and said to him, "Do you know that today the Lord will take away your master from over you?" And he answered, "Yes, I know it. Keep quiet." Then Elijah said to him, "Please stay here, for the Lord has sent me to the Jordan." But he said, "As the Lord lives and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So the two of them went on. 50 men of the sons of the prophets also went and stood at some distance from them, as they both were standing by the Jordan. Then Elijah took his cloak and rolled it up and struck the water, and the water was parted to the one side and to the other till the two of them could go over on dry ground. When they had crossed, Elijah said to Elisha, "Ask what I shall do for you before I am taken from you." And Elisha said, "Please let there be a double portion of your spirit on me." And he said, "You have asked a hard thing. Yet if you see me as I am being taken from you, it shall be so for you, but if you do not see me, it shall not be so." And as they still went on and talked, behold, chariots of fire and horses of fire separated the two of them, and Elijah went up by a whirlwind into heaven. And Elisha said, saw it and cried, "My father, my father, the chariots of Israel and its horsemen." And he saw him no more. Then he took hold of his own clothes and tore them in two pieces. And he took up the cloak of Elijah and then had fallen from him and went back and stood on the bank of Jordan. Then he took the cloak of Elijah that had fallen from him and struck the water, saying, "What is the Lord, the God of Elijah?" And when he had struck the water had parted to the one side and the other. Elisha went over. Now when the sons of prophets who were at Jericho saw him opposite them, they said, "The spirit of Elijah rests on Elisha." And they came to meet him and bowed to the ground before him. Here ends the first lesson.
No turning back. The second lesson for this morning is taken from the Acts of the Apostles, chapter 1, verses 15 to 26. Acts 1, 15 to 26. Matthias is chosen in place of Judas. At this time, Peter stood up in the midst of the brethren. A gathering of about 120 persons was there together, and said, "Brethren, the scripture had to be fulfilled, which the Holy Spirit foretold by the mouth of David concerning Judas, who became a guide to those who arrested Jesus. For he was counted among us and received his share in this ministry. Now this man acquired a field with the price of his wickedness, and falling headlong, he burst open in the middle of and all his intestines gushed out. And it became known to all who were living in Jerusalem, so that in their own language, that field was called Hakeldama, that is, the field of blood. For it is written in the book of Psalms, 'Let his homestead be made desolate, and let no one dwell in it. And let another man take his office.' Therefore, it is necessary that of the men who have accompanied us all the time that the Lord Jesus went in and out among us, beginning with the baptism of John until the day that he was taken up from us, one of these must become a witness with us of his resurrection." So they put forward two men, Joseph called Barsabas, who was also called Justice, and Matthias. And they prayed and said, "You, Lord, who know the hearts of all men, show which one of these two you have chosen to occupy this ministry and apostleship from which Judas turned aside to go to his own place." And they drew lots for them, and the lot fell to Matthias, and he was added to the 11 apostles. May the Lord bless the reading of his word.
In your light we see the light, Jesus, full of light. It's your light that shines upon our world, light our minds. May your light reveal the sin in our hearts as we humbly pray in spirit and the Christ, born of the Virgin Mary, baptized by John, have mercy on us.
We magnify you, Lord our King, the only begotten Son, Word of the Father, Lord Jesus Christ, immortal in your nature, who was born of the Virgin Mary, for the life and salvation of all mankind, without change of nature, you became the Son of Man, and was crucified for us, thus trampling death underfoot, and destroying it forever. You are born of the Trinity, and are worshipped and glorified, equally with your Father, and the living and Holy Spirit. Have mercy on us.
Holy art thou, O God.
Holy art thou, Almighty Lord.
Holy art thou, immortal Lord.
O Lord Jesus Christ, for us, have mercy on us.
Holy art thou, O God.
Holy art thou, Almighty Lord.
Holy art thou, immortal Lord.
Lord, for us, have mercy on us.
Holy art thou, O God.
Holy art thou, Almighty Lord.
Holy art thou, immortal Lord.
Lord, for us, have mercy on us.
Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy.
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 Lord, have mercy. Fill us with the essence of your holy gospel, the teachings of the apostles, the richness of your divine wisdom, and the gift of your Holy Spirit. Enable us to obey your commands gladly and to fulfill your holy will perfectly.
Amen.
From the epistle of Paul to the Galatians, Chapter 1, verses 11 to 17.
Praise to you, Lord, the apostles. O Lord, grant us your grace to discern your word.
I want you to know, brothers and sisters, that the gospel I preached is not of human origin. I did not receive it from any man, nor was I taught it. Rather, I received it by the revelation from Jesus Christ. For you have heard of my previous ways of life in Judaism, how intensely I persecuted the church of God and tried to destroy it. I was advancing in Judaism beyond many of my own age among my people and was extremely zealous for the traditions of my fathers. But when God, who set me apart from my mother's womb and called me by his grace, was pleased to reveal his son in me so that I might preach among him among the Gentiles, my immediate response was not to consult any human being. I did not go up to Jerusalem to see those who were apostles before I was, but I went to Arabia. Later, I returned to Damascus. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Offer sacrifices of praise to the Lord. Come and worship in his holy courts.
Hallelujah.
Brothers and sisters, let us stand in silence, awe, and reverence and listen to the proclamation of the living word of God from the gospel of Jesus Christ our Lord.
Peace be with you all.
May the Lord make us all worthy to listen to his word.
The holy gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, which proclaims life and salvation to the whole world, as recorded by the evangelist Mark. In the days of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, the Word of Life, God incarnate of the Blessed Virgin Mary, he taught in this manner.
So we believe and affirm.
Jesus went up to the mountainside and called to him those he wanted, and they came to him. he appointed 12 that they might be with him, and that he might send them out to preach, and to have an authority to drive out demons. These are the 12 he appointed: Simon, to whom he gave the name Peter, James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John. To them he gave the name Boanerges, which means sons of thunder. Andrew, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, Thomas, James, son of Alphaeus, Thaddeus, Simon the Zealot, and Judas Iscariot, who betrayed him. Peace be with you all.
Closer to you, enable us by your grace to praise you to the living words of your gospel.
Let us pray to the Lord for his blessings and mercy.
O Lord, who is the source of all blessings, help us and bless us.
O Lord, help us continually to offer praise and thanksgiving to you, to him who absolves us from our debts and pardons our sins, to him who receives the penitent and rejoices in the return of sinners, to him who has promised, "Call and I will answer, knock and I will open and stretch forth my hand to pardon your sins and iniquities," to him belongs glory and honor and worship at this time and all the days of our lives. Almighty and glorious Lord, save us from the wile of the evil one. In your grace and mercy, you took flesh of the Blessed Virgin Mary and became human. Lord of lords, do not banish us from your presence and from the company of the angels who continually praise your holy name and proclaim aloud, "The Lord is holy." Show us the way of life and salvation, so that we may persevere to attain your glorious kingdom. Lord Jesus, look upon us with the eye of mercy. Save us from our enemies and all that would hurt us. Protect us in the shadow of your cross. Lord Jesus, save us from all our deceit and greed. Save us from all evil thoughts, defilement, and blasphemy. Lord Jesus, make us to rejoice with all the children of your kingdom. To you and to the Father and to the Holy Spirit, we ascribe all praise and thanksgiving, now and forevermore.
Amen.
O Lord God, who makes a sinner righteous, pardons our sins and makes us holy, blot out all my sins. Through your loving mercy, good Lord, wipe away the sins of all believers. O Lord God, in your mercy and goodness, remember us, our parents, brothers and sisters, our bishop, clergy, teachers of the faith, and all the faithful children of your holy and glorious church. Lord God, comfort us in body, mind, and spirit. Shower your mercy upon us, be the remission of our sin. Make us all worthy of the good end that is set for all children of peace. To you we offer praise and thanksgiving forever and ever.
Amen.
Weak and sinful as we are, let us confess and together say, "Holy is the Holy Father."
Amen.
Holy is the Holy living and Holy Spirit.
Amen.
We believe in the one true God, the Father Almighty,
maker of heaven and earth, and of all things that are in this world. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten Father before all world, light of life, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us and for our salvation came down from heaven, and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary, and was made man, he was also crucified with us, days in the Father's fire, suffered and died, was buried, the third day rose again by his Father's holy will, ascended to heaven, and sits at right hand of the Father. He will come again to glory and judge all living and dead, and his kingdom there be no end. We believe in one Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father, who with the Father, Son, and with the Holy Spirit glorified,
who spoke by the prophets and apostles. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church.
We acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and look forward to the resurrection of the dead, and a new life of the world to come.
All may be seated. Those of you who have come prepared for Thanksgiving prayer for their birthdays, please come forward at this time. Shine, Jesus, shine, fill this land with the Father's glory. Blaze, Spirit, blaze, set our hearts on fire. Flow, river, flow,
let the nations with grace and mercy.
Let us pray. Good and gracious Father, we thank you for all the many blessings that you bestowed upon us, especially the gift of life. Lord, as we celebrate another year, these your dear children come forward with bowed heads before your presence. Lord, stretch out your hand and bless them. Strengthen them, embolden them, Lord, wherever they go, that they may continue to be in the shadow of your cross. Lord, their lives speak many miracles and many blessings. Embolden them, Lord, to be bold in this world and proclaim that you are their Lord and Savior. Lord, we ask and continue to pray for their lives, Lord. Enable them to do great things. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Darkness, shine on.
Those of you who have come prepared to participate in Thanksgiving prayer for another year in your married life, please come forward for the Thanksgiving prayer. While singing the following hymn, offertory will be taken. Let us give thanks. God of all grace, we can never outgive you. As we give you our financial gifts, help us to use the spiritual gifts you have given us. We thank you for giving to each one of us the manifestation of your Spirit for our common good. To each of us, you have given different spiritual gifts to serve you and your church, to build up each one another spiritually. May we serve you continually. May we continue to offer our gifts and spirituality through ministering through your church. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. All may be seated.
Good morning. Everyone's getting to the hang of it. Good morning. That's good. For our meditation this morning, it comes from Mark chapter 3, verses 13 through 19. I just want to read verse 13 again. Jesus went up to the mountainside and called to him those he wanted, and they came to him. Let us pray. God, our Father, creator of all things, true source of light and wisdom, our origin, be ever gracious to us. Let a ray of your light penetrate the darkness of our understanding. Give us confidence in the power of your gospel. Grant us clarity and understanding in proclaiming the truths of your word. Edify your church through this work. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. As we begin today, I would like for us to imagine, if possible, if Jesus appeared to us right here, right now, at this moment here in Mumbai, in Santacruz, and was looking for a group, a band of disciples, what sort of people do you think he might be looking for? Would it perhaps be people with a great amount of influence? Perhaps media-savvy people, trained professionals, public relations majors, graduates and postgraduates, doctors, architects, people who have the ability to orate well, who have good words, good at presenting the right image, perhaps people with good looks. It's interesting, isn't it, that that type of elite group of people is who we would often think about, especially when we think about presenting the glorious gospel of our Christ to the world. But let me ask you something that's a little bit closer to us. If Jesus was here in Mumbai looking for disciples, would he choose you and I? Are we the sort of person he might want in his company? I often pray that the good Lord forgives all of our pitfalls and calls us to the journey alongside him as he continues to work wondrous things in this world. My dear St. Thomas family, today we're going to look at the passage from Mark's gospel and we see what sort of people Christ chose. However, to understand this choosing, we have to understand the context in which we find this passage. Now, for today's reading, we've skipped over about half of the chapter. So let's catch up. We'll remember how Jesus comes into Galilee, proclaiming the good news. He first calls the disciples and proceeds to teach with authority. Christ drives out evil spirits and heals many people. Yet it doesn't take long before people start to wonder who this Jesus could really be. Especially as he teaches with authority and gives orders to evil spirits, and they really obey. Then we see him in this chapter not just healing, but even more so, he goes on to forgive. He forgives people of their sins. And when the religious experts, the authorities, the Pharisees and Sadducees come complaining, he shows them up completely by healing a man who has paralysis. In this passage we skipped over to get today's portion, we see opposition from the Pharisees increasing as this Jesus eats with Levi, a tax collector, and allows his disciples to pick heads of grain on the Sabbath. Goes on to even heal a man on the Sabbath. Each time they would come with accusations and complaints, they're rebuffed, and their true understanding of Scripture is shown through. And so right here at the start of Mark's gospel, we find the Pharisees beginning to plot how to kill Christ. And so we come right before today's reading. Mark tells us that Jesus withdrew in verse 7. But from where? Well, it seems he's gone away from the towns and particularly from the synagogue where the religious authorities were. And since they have rejected him, he goes to where the ordinary people are, out in the countryside. The opposition of the Pharisees, however, hasn't put off the crowd. What they expect was if they stood strong and said Christ was wrong, Jesus was wrong, we are right, the others would follow. But the true light that was in Christ, penetrated that crowd. In fact, the crowd continued to flock to him, to hear him, to be healed by him. In fact, this withdrawal has a strategic impact. Now, people come from all over the countryside, from far away as Jerusalem and Judea, from other side of Jordan and from the coastal cities of Tyre and Sidon. Jesus has moved to an arena where he's accessible to everyone. And notice the implied criticism that Mark has of the Pharisees. They're completely blind to understand who Jesus is. We know in Mark 5, the evil spirit named Legion, who Jesus encounters, recognizes immediately and exactly who he is, falling down before him and crying out, "You are the Son of God." But my dear friends, Jesus doesn't want evil spirits as his followers, so he commands Legion to be silent. Notice, though, that neither does Jesus want a populace falling. He has people flocking to him, hearing him, but he does not want them to follow him just because he can heal them or feed them or even free them from the occupation of Rome. So after a while, he goes and withdraws from them. He goes up onto a mountainside where we read today, away from the crowd, taking with him just those who are his closest followers. He takes up the mountain, and there he calls out the small group, and he selects them, 12 men who will be known as his apostles, those sent out to proclaim the good news. And look at who he appoints. There's Simon, to whom he gave later the name Peter. His nickname is Rock. But his behavior, as we go through the Gospels, is anything but. There's James and John, the sons of thunder. You can imagine what sort of behavior gave them that type of nickname. Essentially, they were hotheads. Prone to go off the deep end. Then there's Matthew or Levi, the tax collector. Not a popular choice among others, but was a choice of Christ. Remember who the tax collector was. Every Sunday, we recite that prayer of confession. Remember those. We must think, who would want an enemy collaborator as a follower, someone who claims to be the king of the Jews? Then there's Simon the Galilean, who in the Gospel of Matthew is described as a zealot. That is a nationalist dedicated to ridding the country of Roman occupation. Imagine what he thought of Matthew. Tamil avarku prayasam kaanuvaayirikkum ennalum they worked. And last but not least, there's Judas Iscariot, who betrayed him. You can't help but think that Mark wants to make it very clear from the start that these are just ordinary human beings with all the failings you'd expect in any other group, especially in these 12. It's not a particular inspiring group of people, is it? When you hear their backgrounds. Not a sort of people you or I would have chosen. But I guess the difference between us choosing, say, two or three people to assist in a service and who Jesus chose to become his disciples is something of a different fact. In fact, there are several differences, even apart from the differences between Jesus and us. Let us suggest a few. The first, there's the issue of whose choice this really is. Here the choice is clearly Jesus, isn't it? He doesn't ask these men whether they feel up to the task. He just chooses them. All they have to do is obey. How often do we obey? Christ has chosen every one of us, is it not? But sometimes we fail to remember to obey. Second, there's the task to which they're called. They're called to be apostles. That is, they're to be sent out to tell others about Jesus and his kingdom. This isn't a position of influence or glory, sitting at the right-hand side of Jesus, like some of them hoped for. Remember the sons of Zebedee. Remember their mother asking in Matthew. Remember in Mark, them asking for sides of authority on the financial, military might. No, this is a task-oriented calling, a calling to go out into the world as Jesus' ambassadors with all the risks that it will entail. Year after year, decade after decade, we hear in our VBSs, we'll be ambassadors of Christ. Saying is a lot more in the negative than doing. When we fail to do what we say, we leave a lot behind. Thirdly, there's an element of separation, which signified by removing them from the crowd and taking them up to the mountain to make their choice. A disciple is called to come out of the crowd and follow Jesus. Elsewhere, he talks about taking up our cross to follow him. I'm not sure we could have a clearer picture of separation from the crowd than that of carrying our cross. Can you see the twofold focus that being a disciple entails? There's being with Jesus, and there's leaving all that we know, all that we're comfortable in knowing, to go out and proclaim that Jesus is our Lord and Savior. Too often we Christians concentrate on the first, but we forget the second. When will we realize? When will we wake up? When would we affirm that? Notice too that going out isn't just a proclaiming the message. It also calls us to cast out demons. Ipo ellarum chindikkana demons cast out cheyano. How will I cast out a demon? Martha must have a demon on her. That is not the demon that I'm talking about. There is another demon that is affecting our spiritual oppression, and that has to do with the preaching the gospel against those systematic evils in our world. These systemic evils, including corruption, religious intolerance, slavery, sex trade, abuse of power, both in government, ecclesiastical, and social institutions. And that's what the church at its best has so often done. In other words, the preaching of the gospel entails setting people free, free from the bondage to sin, most of all, but also freeing humanity that is creating bonds and blinding people, tying them down and saying, this is all it is, reducing us. To free people, for example, could mean from the oppression of those who are enslaving people to understand what needs to happen in our lives to be happy, what clothes we need to wear, what car we need to drive, what amount of money we need to have in our bank accounts. There's also people who are oppressing us through media giants, telling us what we should know about and what we should be interested in. Maybe even what we should think. To free people from the need to chase after every last fad that comes about. But of course, we're talking about Jesus' disciples. Peter, James, and John, and the rest. This doesn't mean us, does it? You may be thinking that we're not good enough to be one of those Jesus disciples anyway. But as we just understood, the disciples were a mixed band of people, mostly just ordinary people, distinguished only by the fact that Jesus had chosen them. But that's the point, isn't it? Jesus chose them. We too are people that God has chosen to follow him. We too are those that Jesus was talking about when he instructed his disciples to go out into all the world and make more disciples, teaching them and to doing all that he commanded them to do. So here's where the rubber hits the road. Are we one of Jesus' disciples? Close your eyes and think, are we one of Jesus' disciples? Have we withdrawn to be with Jesus rather than with the vast majority of those who want to have nothing to do with him? Are we learning from him rather than from the far louder voices of our world? And having withdrawn to learn from him, are we now ready to go back out into the world to tell them about him? Or does it sound too scary, too crazy, too cliche? Well, it doesn't need to be any of those things, nor does it need to be complicated. It might be as simple as explaining to someone who's heard about Jesus but doesn't understand. We recall Philip and the Ethiopian eunuch, yes? And chapter 8 of Acts of the Apostles. It might just be talking about Christian community you're a part of, or inviting a friend to one of our low-key community programs. Just giving that inclination is something of a great deal. One of the dangers for people like us who belong to a church that has lots going on is that we become so focused on the logistics of church activities rather than the mission itself. We get so focused on criticizing. We get so focused on saying, no, I have a better idea than you. Our ego and our attitude changes ourselves. My dear friends, this is when the wolf comes in. We've encountered so much opposition in our lives and have sometimes settled to become pessimistic in our mindset, forgetting that it is God who is faithful, God who has called us, God who will allow us to walk. So the question for us today is, how do we focus our gospel? How do we arrange our gospel? Is it inward or outward? Will we keep the gospel message only for ourselves, like a close-knitted community? Or will we go beyond and proclaim the gospel? A few weeks ago, we celebrated the Feast of Pentecost, did we not? We remember hearing in the verses read, Jesus' last words to the disciples were, "But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth." Acts 1:8. Well, here we are in Mumbai. Millennia later, the financial and entertainment capital of India. My dear friends, where will we begin? Where will we begin? My dear family, I end today with recalling a reading in a book titled Questions of Life by Nikki Gumbel, where it describes a story about a man named Albert McMahon, a 24-year-old farmer who became a Christian. He was so enthusiastic that he would go around the neighborhood and fill his truck to help people meet Jesus, to hear at a revival. Now, there was a good-looking farmer's son whom he was especially keen to. He really wanted to persuade this young man who was so busy falling in and out of love, following the world, living a life he had chose. In actuality, he didn't seem like he was attracted to Christianity at all. But McMahon knew that he needed to persuade this young boy to come to Christ. Eventually, he did. He did it by enticing him to drive his truck. When he got there that night, something unfathomable happened. His ears perked up, his eyes widened, he started receiving the gospel. He started believing. And night after night, and night after night, and night after night, he would continue to come and come and come to hear the good news. And one night, he finally gave his life to Jesus Christ. Since then, that young farmer's son, that young truck driver, has spoken to at least 250 million people in this world. He became the spiritual advisor to 9 U.S. presidents. My dear friends, that young truck driver, that young man who was a part of the world, who gave it all to Christ, is Billy Graham. Billy Graham, one who was a well-known evangelist, who preached the gospel, who stood his faith, and now is asleep in the Lord. We are not called all to be Billy Graham, are we? But we can be an Albert McMahon. My dear parents, at your homes, pray aloud. Pray aloud that your family can hear you. Dear fathers, today you celebrate Father's Day the world over. When you pray at home, pray aloud, pray strong, that your children may hear you. If you feel that they're lacking in spiritual prayer or coming to church, pray aloud that they may hear, that my parents' cries may reach the heavens, that I have a duty, I have a faith, I have a responsibility. My dear young adults, young children, you are exposed to so much more than what was exposed years ago. You too have a voice to hear, to lead, and believe in Christ. Let your voices proclaim the goodness that is in God. Let your voices speak the truth. The challenges that we all have as much a part to play in fulfilling the Great Commission as Billy Graham or Albert McMacken. We just have a different way. Each one of us is unique, and only we can fulfill the role that God has called us to. And that is an awesome responsibility, is it not? Do you take this as a burden, or do you take it as a responsibility? Much like you are responsible for studying, much like you're responsible for getting up each morning to go to work, to provide with your family, how much more responsible are we in proclaiming the good news that is in our Lord, either in our family, our community, and society? My dear family, this week we meditate on discipleship. The Bible passages we all read today had to do with discipleship. It is our responsibility to read, to reread, to meditate, imbibe it, and to live it in our lives. Let us meditate and pray that our lives may be closer to the glory of our God. Let us pray. Good and gracious Father, we thank you for these moments that you've given us, especially for allowing us to be here in your awesome presence. Good God, as we meditate on discipleship, we ask and pray that you mold us, call us, allow us to be able to see you and hear you. Allow those we come in contact with be able to see the grace of you on our face and in our actions and our words. Lord, as we come preparing ourselves to receive communion, to participate in this holy Kurbana, help us to know you better. Help us to know those who are sitting in front of us and behind us, to the sides of us. Allow us to proclaim and pray with them that you are a great God. We pray for our dear children. We pray for our parents, the grandchildren, Lord God. Bless them and enable them to become good and faithful disciples. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Those of you who have come prepared to participate in the Holy Kurbana, please stand up in your respective places and repeat this prayer, a confession, with me. I confess that I have sinned against you. O Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, in thought, word, and deed, I'm sorry with all my heart for these my sins. I believe in your promise that you receive those who truly repent. O Lord, who are merciful and full of grace, accept me even as you accepted the publican, the woman who was a sinner, and the thief on the cross, and comfort me by the consolation of your word. O Lord, grant that your holy body and holy blood, in which I now partake, may not bring me to judgment and condemnation, but to life and wholeness. Amen. May God Almighty be compassionate to you who have truly confessed your sins, and may freely forgive your sins and make you worthy to partake in this Holy Communion.
Dearly beloved, pray with me that this service may be acceptable to the Lord.
We come to your house and you pray for your blessings. Sanctify your servants by your truth. O Lord, hear and answer the prayers of your people. You have promised that 2 or 3 are gathered in your name. You will be in our midst. We pray that you send us the gift of the Holy Spirit to make his dwelling in us your people, as he dwelt in the apostles.
O God and Lord of all, make us worthy to greet one another with the kiss of peace. Freed from all insecurity and united in love, to you, all Father, to you, our only Son, to your only Son, and to your Holy Spirit, we give you praise and glory now and forever.
Amen.
Peace be with you all.
And with you also.
In the love of our Lord God, let us greet one another in peace.
Brothers and sisters, having received this holy and divine peace, let us bow our heads before the merciful Lord.
Gracious Lord, we bow before you.
Merciful Lord, you dwell on high, yet condescend to look upon things that are lowly. Bless now those who have bowed their heads in your presence with the grace of your only Son, with whom and with the Holy Spirit you accept all praises and glory, now and forever.
Amen.
Beloved brothers and sisters, let us participate in the Holy Kurbana, which is now offered to us with commitment, reverence, humility, purity of heart, love, true faith and devotion. To God the Father, to whom all things belong, is offered the sacrifice of grace, peace and praise in the spirit of unity and concord.
The love of God the Father, the grace of the only begotten Son, and the communion abiding presence of the Holy Spirit be with you all, dearly beloved, forever.
And also with you.
May our hearts be with Christ on high.
Hearts truly are with the Lord.
To sing praises and worship the Creator of all things.
Surely is good and right.
Who is adored by the heavenly host, sun and moon and all the stars, the earth and seas and all that dwell there, angels and archangels, thrones and powers, cherubim and seraphim, ever proclaiming.
Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. Heaven and earth are full of his glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
When the sinless one of his own will chose to suffer death for us sinners, he took bread in his holy hand.
Bless, O Lord.
He gave thanks, blessed, sanctified, and broke it, gave it to his apostles, saying, take, eat, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me.
Amen.
In the same manner, he took the cup.
Bless, O Lord.
He gave thanks, blessed, sanctified, and gave it to his apostles, saying, drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for many for the forgiveness of sins.
Amen.
Thus, as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, You proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.
Lord, we remember your death. We celebrate your resurrection. We await your second coming. May your blessing rest upon us all.
O Lord, as we remember your death, burial, resurrection, ascension, and look forward to your second coming to judge the world in righteousness and truth, we offer this service and sacrifice entreating you not to deal with us according to our sins, but according to your abundant mercy, and saying,
have mercy on us, O Lord our God. We give thanks to you, we praise you, we glorify you, we worship you, the source of all goodness. Have mercy on us and bless us.
Answer unto us, O Lord. Answer unto us, O Lord. Answer unto us, O Lord, by your grace. Have mercy upon us.
Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy.
May the Holy Spirit sanctify this bread, that the body of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
May the Holy Spirit sanctify the wine in this chalice, that it may be the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
O Lord, sanctify the bodies and souls of those who receive these gifts, that they may bear the fruit of stability of your holy church. Establish ever firmly your holy church, founded on the rock of faith, against which the gates of hell shall not prevail, and preserve her to the end, whereum strife and error. To you, with the Son and the Holy Spirit, we offer praise and thanksgiving, both now and forever.
Amen.
Look with mercy, O Lord, on your holy church throughout the world, on all the bishops who bear the burden of leading and guiding her, especially our Father in God, the Metropolitan, the moderators of CSI and CNI, Archbishop of the Anglican Communion, our Suffragan Metropolitans, our Diocesan Episcopa, other bishops, priests, deacons, evangelists, faithful members of the Church, and seekers of the faith. Lord, we remember all who exercise authority in various countries, especially in this country. Give to each one your Holy Spirit, that they may diligently work in your vineyard.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, we remember the Mother of our Lord, the Blessed Virgin Mary, the holy apostles, the prophets, the preachers, the evangelists, the martyrs, the confessors, and all the saints. Lord, we remember the three councils of Nicaea, Constantinople, and Ephesus, and all the holy fathers who participated in them. Make us worthy to follow in their footsteps. Lord, we also remember all the faithful who are departed and fallen asleep in true faith. Grant that we also may with them be counted worthy of the remission of our sins and be gathered into your heavenly kingdom.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, we thank you for the beautiful universe you have created and the life and possibilities of it. Forgive us, O Lord, for we have distorted the universe for our greed and selfishness. Help us, O Lord, to be good and faithful stewards for the fulfillment of your will.
Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy.
The blessings of our great God and Savior Jesus Christ be with you all forever.
Brothers and sisters, we must pray to the Lord always for reconciliation and peace and for his blessings and mercy.
Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers.
Let us pray to the Lord for unity in the church and harmony between all people and communities.
Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers.
Let us pray for our peace in our families and grace in our hearts, that we may be strengthened in faith.
Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers.
Let us pray for the recovery of health for the sick, comfort for the distressed, deliverance for prisoners, safety for travelers, unity and love for those who are estranged.
Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers.
Let us give glory to God the Father, Lord of all, worship his only begotten Son, and praise his holy and life-giving Spirit.
Lord of all blessings, we commit our lives into your keeping and pray for your blessings. Gracious God, have mercy upon us and bless us.
Let us take a few moments for our intercessory prayers. Lord, these days remember the goodness that you have bestowed upon us. As we remember in the message today, we seek you and call upon your holy name to receive us and to use us for your glory. We especially pray at this moment for our dear fathers as the world celebrates Father's Day. The lives they've lived, the sacrifices they've done for their families, the love they give and the care they share. Lord, we give you thanks and praise for the family that we have, especially our fathers. We ask and pray that you embolden them and strengthen them as they continue to be with us. Good God, remember those who are about to return to their classes or who are already beginning the new academic year. We ask and pray that you lift up their hearts, open their minds, unshackle their doubts, that their tongue may be sharp, their eyes strong, their wit unabridged. Give them the knowledge that they need so that they can succeed. Not only in secular life, but in spiritual life as well. Allow them to use the gifts that you have given them for the glory of your kingdom. Lord, through our thubdens and our litany, we once again recall those prayers. As one community, we beseech you, O Lord, to hear our prayers. Lord, at this moment, we pray for our dear Nidhanachan and his family. Continue to strengthen Achin as he works amongst the youths in Bombay and his ministry and his family life. Allow it all to be for your glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. O God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, make perfect the offerings and oblations presented before you. Sanctify our bodies, souls, and spirits so that with a pure and confident heart, we may address you as God and Father and pray, Our Father in heaven.
Hallowed be your name. May your kingdom come. May your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Do not bring us to the time of trial, but deliver us from the evil one. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
May the grace, mercy, and blessing of the Holy and Glorious Trinity, uncreated, self-existent, eternal, adorable, and one in essence, be with you all, dearly beloved, forever.
And also with you, O Holy and Glorious Trinity, have mercy upon us.
Holy things for holy people.
Holy is the one Father, holy is the one Son, holy is the one Spirit.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
One from the beginning, forever and ever. Amen.
The one Holy Father who created the world in his mercy is with us.
Amen.
The one Holy Son who saved it by the precious passion is with us.
Amen.
The
one living Holy Spirit who makes perfect and fulfills all that is and that has been is with us. May the name of the Lord be blessed as in the beginning, both now and forever.
Amen. Now as we come to your table, we recall those gone before us. Prepare this communion. You are our hope and salvation. We bow our heads in your presence as we share in your body and blood.
Have mercy, Lord, have mercy.
Lord, 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 have mercy. Dearly beloved, pray for me.
Bless us, O Lord.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be. Amen. O Lord, at your command death held its sway. You abolished death through your resurrection from the dead. Therefore we praise and exalt you. O Lord, every mouth shall sing your praise. O Lord, who gathers up the children of Adam from everywhere, bless us and help us. O Son of God, your death has changed our death into life. Raise us from the dust so that we may ever praise you. God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit is worthy of glory and worship forever. From the beginning and from generation to generation, may he be praised. Hallelujah.
O Son of God, who came for our salvation and will come again for our resurrection and the renewal of our race, grant, we pray, forgiveness of our sins to you, to your servants, through your atoning sacrifice.
Amen.
O Lord, graciously bless these your children who partake of your most precious body and blood, which was given on Calvary for the forgiveness of sins, that they may abide in your presence forever.
Amen.
The blessings of Jesus Christ, our great God and Savior, be on those who bear these sacred mysteries, on those who dispense them, on those who receive them, and all who have participated and who shall participate in them. The grace of God be on us all, both now and forever.
Lord, have mercy and bless us.
Glory and praise be to you, O Lord, and an everlasting refuge.
The holy body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, broken and shed on Calvary for the forgiveness of sins, are given to you for the health of your body and soul.
comfortable.
Praise be to you, O Lord, our God forever. Praise be to you, O Lord Jesus Christ. May the holy blood and blood which we have partaken be not for our condemnation, but for our life and salvation for us all. O God, grant us your blessings.
Holy God, shall bow down before you, and every tongue shall praise your holy name, for you give life to the dead, and you are the hope of all mankind. We praise you, Lord, and we give thanks for your mercy towards us.
We praise you, O Lord, because in your abundant mercy you have fed and strengthened us with the precious body and blood from your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. And you have thereby made us one with him, and with all the members of his mystical body, we pray you to give us grace to continue in that holy fellowship, and ever to offer glory and praise to you, and to your holy begotten Son, and to your Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Bless us, O Lord Almighty. You are our God, the Creator. Show to us ever the way of salvation. Our God, helper of all. My beloved brothers and sisters, I commend you to the grace and blessings of the Holy and Glorious Trinity. Go now in peace and serve the Lord with the gifts and blessings that you have received from the atoning sacrifice of the Lord.
Amen.
You both near and far, who are saved by the victorious cross of the Lord and sealed with the seal of holy baptism, this Holy Trinity will forgive you your sins and comfort your soul.
Amen.
Pray for me, my brothers and sisters, weak and sinful as I am, that I may obtain mercy. Go in peace, filled with joy and gladness and rejoicing. All may be seated. Praise be to God. Next Sunday, we will be having the Holy Kurbana at 7:30, in English at 7:30, and Malayalam Holy Kurbana at 9:30 a.m. We have announcement from the Marthoma Voluntary Evangelist Association, Mumbai Center. Respected Achan and members of the parish, Marthoma Voluntary Evangelist Association, Mumbai Center, is inviting your participation in Isho Mar Timotheos Episcopal Memorial Bible Quiz Competition, to be held on Sunday, the 31st July, 2022, immediately after the fifth Sunday fellowship meeting at St. Thomas Marthoma Church, Basin Road. 75% of the questions will be from the Acts of the Apostles and the Book of Amos, and the remaining 25% will be general questions from the Bible.
From each parish, a group of 4 members can participate in the competition. Do not miss this blessed opportunity to dive deep into the Word of God. Edowa Mission Secretary should give the names of the participants from your parish to the Center Secretary by June 20th, 2022. The winners of the previous competition held in 2019 should return their ever-rolling trophy to the MTVA office bearers on July 31st, 2021. Requesting your prayers, presence, and participation, yours in his service for the Marthoma Voluntary Evangelist Association, Mumbai Center, Honorable Rural Secretary, Ms. Bina V. Abraham, President, Reverend Eben Abraham. We have a Sunday school announcement as well. Notice for the annual general body meeting. Notice is hereby given that the annual general body meeting of the Marthoma Sunday School Santacruz will be held on Sunday, 26 June 2022, immediately after the Malayalam Holy Kurbana in the church. All the Sunday School teachers are kindly requested to attend this meeting. Agenda 1, to receive and adopt the annual report for the year 2021-22, to ratify the expenses in excess and or without the budget provisions for the year 21-22, to approve the annual accounts for the year 21-22, to approve the budget for the year 22-23, AOB with the permission of the chair. For and on behalf of the St. Thomas Marthoma Sunday School, Santacruz, Mumbai, Honorable Secretary Jolie Thomas. Dated 17 June 2022. We have announcement from the Eugena Sakyam as well. St. Thomas Marthoma Eugena Sakyam Santacruz, respected members, greetings in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Notice is hereby given that the AGM for the year 21-22 will be held on 3rd July, Sunday 2022, after the Malayalam Holy Kurbana. Service to transact the following business agenda. Agenda item number 1, annual report for the year 21-22, accounts for 21-22, presenting budget for year 22-23, AOB with the permission of the chair, requesting everyone to make yourselves available to attend the same. Regards, Secretary Rijan Abraham. Dear family, a combined Eugena Sakyam and Youth Fellowship meeting will be held at the church immediately after this service. Our main speaker is our dear Reverend Nitin John Chacko Achin. With that, I would like to thank Achin for his wonderful presence today, his comforting tone, and for his ability to enliven our worship service this morning. Achin, as you know, was with us for a couple years, and now he has been transferred as the Mumbai Youth Chaplain. Achin's ministry is going strong, and he is participating in many things. So again, we want to thank Achin for his valuable time, for being with us this morning. Do we have any visitors here with us today? If so, please stand up. No visitors with us today? With that said, let's move to our doxology.
May the grace, mercy, and blessings of the Triune God continue to be with us all. May the Holy Ghost fill us with the power and grace to live and work for the glory of God, now and forevermore.